Are you going to tell us all about some crazy cool thing some random person built that's going to make me feel worse about my programming skills? Because I got some serious work to do.
We can do that later, Frank.
All right. So just first, welcome. This is your first build?
It is.
Yeah.
First so, time.
For a lot of people in the room, this is the first time hearing from you since you joined Microsoft. What have you been up to here?
Yeah, so I joined Microsoft at the end of October last year. So it's been, what, 7 months almost, right? And what have I learned? Well, I'd say it has been a just epic fast pace, right? I think in terms of trying to understand everything going on in this company, which, you know, I've probably not even scratched the surface, then also organizing the new team that I think we're going to talk about a little bit, and to keep up with the fast-changing, crazy world that Kevin told us about. It's really, some days you're just like, what happened today, right? What did I actually get done today? Because there's so much changing around you all the time. But it's been, I would say, one of the things that is very, very striking to me as somebody who's never worked at Microsoft before, but you know a lot about Microsoft, grew up with Microsoft in you know, in all of our lives, but the amount of innovation that you see from the outside versus then what you feel and see going on inside the company is just profoundly different, right? Getting inside the company, you just meet tons and tons of smart people doing all sorts of things, from big distributed systems work to cutting edge security research and dealing with nation state attacks to building all sorts of different types of products, serving all of these enterprises out there, the work that's going on in Microsoft research, the work that we're doing to serve developers, and the list just goes on and on and on, right? So it is awesome. It's energizing, one, to just be around so many smart, diverse people, but two, just to see this like pace that needs to pick up everywhere but inside of Microsoft to try to put these building blocks together and solve these problems that we've been talking about.
Yeah, we got, and on Tuesday you'll have a chance to show some of the stuff you've been working on too. So now before you came to Microsoft, you were the CEO of Lacework, and then before that you were at Facebook, where you spent a decade scaling from something that was very small to something that was very, very large, and now you run what we call Core AI here at Microsoft. Like, tell us a little bit about like what the group is and what the vision behind it is.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I would say that, you know, in order to maybe just tack on to what Kevin was saying here, is that this entire way of building these AI applications is just changing so fast, right? And the difference here is that maybe in the past couple of decades, we built software where, you know, all of us, we'd go out there, we'd talk to customers, we'd come up with some requirements, we'd come back, we'd design some database schema, we'd go write some code around it, maybe some other systems, and then we'd put some user experience around it. And that's what we did for decades and built lots of great products, great companies, et cetera. But now, when you look at the paradigm shift here and kind of that drawing that Kevin put up there, now the models are at the center of this stack, and these models, they plan, they reason, they think, they can call different tools, they can call each other, and they're also advancing at such a rapid rate. So the goal for the Core AI team really is to build the new stack, the stack that allows somebody to build these AI-driven applications or these new agents in a way that really tried to take advantage of the capabilities that are in these models, right? So you have lots of models, big ones, small ones, different special purpose ones, very, very general ones, and then you want to build these AI-native applications, but the way we thought about building applications and any sort of systems in the past without AI just profoundly have changed for us. And they're changing really rapidly, right? The ecosystem, the frameworks, et cetera. So Core AI is really trying to reimagine the end-to-end developer experience using AI, and then building on a platform that becomes your factory for these AI applications and agents. And then we're embedding and we're making sure that security and trust is baked in right from the start. So we'll talk more about that in the next couple days. And then also giving you an option around how you deploy this from the cloud all the way to local or to the edge.
Yeah, one of the things that I hear you talk a lot about is the need for speed on some of this stuff. How do you ramp up the speed of development and tests and experimentation? How do you sort of motivate and think through change like that?
Absolutely. I think there's inside Microsoft, this is all about for us around learning faster, right? So speed is all about learning faster. The world is changing so fast with all the technologies, with all the different applications, with the different companies out there. And so it is really just about how do you create that learning loop, or how do you have a learning loop that's just faster and faster and faster over time, right? And so part of that's cultural. I'd say part of this is maybe 25% to 33% is like a cultural thing. And then I would say the rest is how do you build the tools, the infrastructure that allow your product makers to go fast, to be able to iterate, be able to learn fast.
So we're here for Build, and so Satya kicks off tomorrow, and then you're up there on the big stage on day two. I know you've been sweating over the demos and whatnot. How are you feeling about everything, and what should people expect to see there on stage?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think what you're going to see in the next couple days is just a lot of things that we want folks to try out and to build with. And that, I think, is the most exciting thing for me and for the team, is we've been working hard for many months here to really push to build stuff that's working, that's ready to try, to compose, to put together, and then we want your feedback, right? And it cuts across the entire portfolio, from things that help your employees with maybe M365 Copilot or Copilot Studio or other parts of that stack, to developer tools and GitHub Copilot, different types of agents that we're going to talk about that can really help you move through your work as a developer faster and faster and faster, but then also the underlying platform that we call Foundry that really is the place where you get to tap into these different models, these primitives that Kevin talked about. And we work really closely with Kevin's team and other company or other parts of the business here to really try to embed those primitives into Foundry so that our internal product teams can take advantage of those, but then our external customers can take advantage of those. So support for things like MCP, accessing your data, securing that, et cetera. So those capabilities, we've actually got a lot to go try out.
A lot of demos.
Yeah, I got a lot of demos to figure out.
Yeah.
It better work.
Real demos, live on stage. What could go wrong?
They are live. They are live.
It's going to be great. So one of the concepts that you talk a lot about is around turning the Azure AI Foundry into this agent factory, right? That, you know, you've talked about that. And when Bill and Paul started Microsoft, they had the idea of the software factory. You wrote about it on LinkedIn, which I thought was great. And obviously a lot has changed over the 50 years, but feels like the essence of that vision is still hanging out. So talk a little bit about why you've picked this up as a drive and a metaphor.
Yeah, absolutely. So I actually didn't know about the software factory tidbit from Bill back in 1975. So when he and I were chatting, I think it was earlier this year, I was explaining to him this concept that we had for the team around building this set of tools, this platform to, one, internally help Microsoft become and have this agent factory, but then potentially having companies that use Microsoft and build on Microsoft to turn themselves into their own agent factories, right? So I was explaining this to Bill, and he kind of stopped, and he got excited, and then he told me this story about how he had this vision when he started Microsoft about it being the software factory, and the software factory being that, you know, it wasn't just about building one application, that it was gonna be a company where he and Paul and others were gonna hire a bunch of really smart programmers, and they were just gonna build a lot of very useful software and do it all connected, packaged as one company, and they could learn and iterate and really solve these problems. Instead of having a company buy all these different point solutions, Microsoft could be that software factory for you, right? So in some ways, that vision kind of fell into this agent factory thing, and then it was an odd parallel from 50 years ago. But I think it just is more apropos for the AI age, where really we went from building these simple applications around chatbots And you know, now we're seeing more and more organizations kind of moving into these applications that are really driving business outcomes for them, where there's real ROI to them, and they're taking advantage of more and more agents, right? Even just prepping some of the build sessions today, talking to some of the customers, the startups that I work with, they're moving into these like very sophisticated multi-agent orchestration systems that are actually functioning as entire like mini departments, mini functions, or running an entire application area. So that's what the Agent Factory has to support for all of us builders out there. This is what it's for.
So one of the one of the things about Microsoft is it's always been a platform company. And a lot of times, sometimes the world tends to look at things in the technology sector, in particular, through the lens of competition. And so people say, well, wait a minute, like how can you be supporting OpenAI and Mistral and 5.4 and Sonnet side by side on those? So spend a little time sort of talking about the value of that ecosystem and why it's a feature, not a bug.
Yeah, absolutely. I think I would say maybe three things here. One is that it is just super early right now, and things are changing super fast, right? So as you know, Kevin talked about also, when you think about the web, if we had picked some very specialized stack by a bunch of vendors or one vendor, I think the web would look very different than it does today, right? So it is in a world, one, that's moving fast. Two is, I think there are a lot of use cases that we yet can't imagine, right? We talk about these maybe healthcare benefits, we talk about these other agentic applications or these ways to assist folks in different types of teams out there, but I think there's just so many use cases out there that we can't even see and understand today, kind of in that capability overhang that Kevin mentioned as well. So we've got to stay open in being able to iterate and being able to swap in different types of frameworks, whatnot. And by definition, to me, a platform is one that does provide choice, that it is open for developers, for builders, that it also kind of morphs and evolves over time. You know, as somebody who spent a fair amount of my career in and helping drive open source efforts, both in software and in hardware, you know, you really see what a great community can do to drive that innovation and drive that adoption. And that's what it's going to take to get to this ubiquitous state of accepting, adopting, using, benefiting from AI.
I heard you say one time, every engineer is a performance engineer.
I still want to know where you heard that from.
What does that mean when you think about tokens as the new currency?
Yeah, absolutely. I think for me, performance is just something that we do to be great engineers, right? You care about this from a user experience perspective. You want your latency, you want your response time to be super fast in whatever you do. People are impatient, people don't have time, people want to do more with per unit time. So we as builders kind of owe that responsibility to our users that everything has to be fast. Now, with performance and just doing hardcore performance engineering, we do want the models and these applications that we're building to be interactive, to be fast, to be efficient, right? Because the more capability we can give per unit time and the cheaper it is, that is going to drive more and more adoption, more and more use cases, right? So this kind of goes hand in hand. Like, we want people to consume more AI. We need that to be cheaper to do that more, you know, with less dollars. We're going to need to give them more functionality at the same time. But this is also just part of what we're riding is this, you know, 10x reduction in cost per year, which is a crazy fast change.
So Kevin said that tomorrow he's going to give us a look at the next 12 months, but he hasn't done it yet. So you have the opportunity here to just sort of get ahead of him a little bit. Looking past build, what are you excited about for the next year, and what are developers have to look forward to?
I would be shocked that Kevin and I are at all not gonna, we would say the same thing. So I'll leave it up to Kevin to share his 12-month roadmap. What am I excited about? I'm excited about a few things here. Well, lots of things. One is, I believe that we have a really, really great set of updates coming out over the next couple of days of news. And I think there are lots of different places as a community here that you get to go and be curious and try and experiment with. And you know, we're still learning a lot, right? These things are not done, they're not finished, they're not perfect. We want your feedback. We're picking up the pace in lots of places in the company to just iterate, to learn, to ship a lot more frequently as well, right? So that's gonna be really fun to just see what the community does with everything that we're talking about in the next couple of days. And then I also think that when we start to tease some of these probably further out there innovations that we've been working out on, we're gonna set, I think, some pretty far, like bigger ambitions in terms of what the technology can do. And that should, we may not know what to do with it right away because it's gonna sound, you know, very maybe academic at first, but I'm excited to see what problems people try to solve with it.
Okay, I think that's probably all the time that we've got. So thanks for that. It's super interesting. And thanks to Kevin for his presentation as well. And now is when we say goodbye to everybody who has joined us remotely. Thank you again. And I hope you have a chance to see us tomorrow during the keynotes and again on Tuesday.